Dear colleagues, dear friends, it's our great pleasure to have this joint venture of Russian Ophthalmology Society webinar during the Cake and Pie Expo. We are very much pleased with this opportunity to interact with our colleagues from the Asia-Pacific region. We know that magazines like Cake and Pie made by Media Mice are very popular in that region, and we will be happy to present at least a small portion of what we have here in Russia of the research in the various fields. And we specifically asked the leading specialists that are living in the eastern part of Russia, from Yekaterinburg, from Ural Mountains to Khabarovsk, to Far East, to present. And I believe that that will be a good and very nice presentation of what's happening in ophthalmology in that region of Russia. Let me start the presentation by introducing Dr. Marina Shanturova, who is a very well-known specialist, not only in Russia, but abroad, having numerous awards on different techniques of reconstruction surgery with iris. Please, Marina, we're looking forward for your talk.
Good afternoon, dear colleagues. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. Today, I would like to present a report, Reconstructive Surgery, Correction of the Iris Defects of the Various Origins. No doubt, the problem we are going to discuss is very important and relevant. The iris damage results in the diaphragmatic dysfunction, leading to spherical and chromatic aberration, double vision, in some cases to severe photophobia, reduced visual acuity, even in transparent optical structures. It also causes a serious cosmetic defect, especially for patients with light irises, and can reduce the functional result of the cataract surgery. The iris defect correction was first tried in the 19th century. Due to technical capabilities of that time, surgeons first began to correct iridodialysis by pinching the torn edge of the iris in the incision. However, those attempts were not successful. At the beginning of the 20th century, surgeons tried to suture the torn iris to the root. With the development of microsurgical technologies, the range of the iris defect that could be eliminated has also expanded. The contribution of the Soviet ophthalmology school to the iridoplasty development cannot be overestimated. The desire of ophthalmic surgeons to find the most effective and safest method of surgery has led to the evolution of cataract removal technologies from large incision surgery to microinvasive energy cataract surgery. And our clinic was one of the first in Russia to introduce phaco emulsification technology into the routine surgery practice. With the development of this technology and a number of indications for phaco emulsification in complicated cases, it was necessary to develop closed iridoplasty for various iris defect correction. So, two large groups can be defined, congenital and acquired. As for congenital, glaucomas of the iris are more common here. And acquired or post-traumatic, which is characterized by a large polymorphism that can be presented by glaucomas, iridodialysis, mydriasis, and partial or complete aniridia. The choice of optimal surgery for iridoplasty depends on many factors, but mainly on the type of the defect and the degree of the iris mobility, determined both at the stage of diagnostic examination and finally during the surgical treatment. Congenital glaucoma of the iris is just a story. This is a big and specific group of patients. In our clinic, we have done much work to develop a diagnostic algorithm to minimize the risk during the surgery. The developed surgical treatment technology was presented at annual Asia-Pacific Congress of Cataract and Refractive Surgeons and got the first prize. Let me present the first video. You can see the removal of the congenital glaucoma of the iris. What is interesting here? This is a 6-year-old blonde girl with blue eyes. Her parents are worried about the different shape of the pupil, which is very noticeable. Besides, the girl will study at school next year. A collective decision has been made on surgical correction of the defect despite high visual acuity, 0.5, and a clear lens. Thanks to developed technique and availability of high-quality OVD and micro tools, the operation was performed successfully. The operation is being performed through a single corneal synthesis. In this case, we prefer to use a cohesive viscoelastic. It perfectly saves the depth of the anterior chamber, does not adhere to the anterior capsule of the lens, and is easily evacuated from the eye at the final stage. Knot sutures are being applied. Here we use a sliding knot technique with polypropylene thread 10-00. The depth of the anterior chamber is almost stable during the whole operation. This guarantees avoiding the damage of the endothelium. And what is also very important in this case, the use of cohesive viscoelastic that allows avoiding trauma of the anterior capsule of the lens in order to prevent future clouding of the lens. And finally, we evacuated the viscoelastic bimanually. The operation is successfully completed. Both the girl and her parents are happy with the result. And now let's turn to the acquired iris defect. Eye injuries in 30 to 80% of cases result in various iris defects. Therefore, the development of new technologies and modification of existing closed iridoplasty method are constantly in process, and we are actively working at this problem, as you can see on the slide. So, mydriasis is a typical outcome of a contusion trauma. The first and necessary manipulation during the surgery is to determine the iris mobility. First, the iris trauma is delicately massaged with a spatula. To define the final degree of the iris mobility, a micro tweezers is used. The iris is gently pulled up by the pupillary edge from the periphery to the center along to the entire circle. At the same time, this manipulation allows separating possible synechia in the iris tissue and possible gonium synechia. In this case, the knot suture technique is used. Most often, knot sutures are applied in the contralateral meridians. This is either 3 to 9 hours or 6 to 12 hours, as you can see in the video. The final location and the number of sutures are determined by the surgeon, depending on the intraoperative situation. The next video. We have developed and presented the modified circlage suture technique, which is called whip stitch circlage suture. Its key feature is the direction of the needle from the pigment iris layer to the anterior chamber. Thus, after tying the knot, we get an excellent cosmetic effect of the pupil in contrast to the common technique when the suture is applied along the pupillary margin and after time the not so called the bug effect is got. The surgery is performed through three corneal syntheses. We use a curved 15 mm needle with the polypropylene 10-00 thread. As an additional manipulator, as you can see, a spatula fork is used here. This tool easily lifts the papillary margin, fixed it in the process of puncturing, and performs the function of a sewing machine foot. We apply the whip stitch circlage suture counterclockwise. The distance between stitches and from the papillary margin is about 2 mm. To prevent the capture of corneal tissue in the process of needle removal from the anterior chamber, we use a 27 gauge guide cannula. At the final, we tie the suture and use a slightly modified triple surgical knot, which allows forming a controlled pupil of a target diameter, which is about 3.2 or 3.5 millimeters. The final stage of operation you can see on screen. Using our method, we have operated about 1,000 patients. The method was presented at the European Congress of Cataract and Refractive Surgeons and was highly appreciated by experts. As for iridodialysis, that was a starting point for the iridoplasty development. And for the correction of iridodialysis, a large number of different methods have been proposed. The U-shaped iridoscleral suturing is most often and most easily used. It can be used ab interna, as shown in this video, or ab externa, using a needle guides. In our opinion, one of the most important points here, the knot which is located on the sclera, must be buried either into the scleral notch or into the scleral tunnel to prevent its protrusion through the conjunctiva in the postoperative period. Iridodialysis is an interesting problem we are actively trying to solve. The modified sewing machine technique, first proposed by Ravi Kumar, was presented by us at the European Congress of Cataract and Refractive Surgeons and published in several issues of the Video Journal of Cataract and Refractive Surgery. Look at the video. First, we perform a scleral incision. For iridoplasty, we use a 30-gauge injection needle. We insert a 10-00 polypropylene thread into the needle. We bend the needle at 45 degrees for a comfort manipulation in the anterior chamber. The operation is performed through a single corneocentesis. To maintain the depth of the anterior chamber, we use a cohesive viscoelastic. Through the corneocentesis, we insert a 30-gauge needle into the anterior chamber, puncture the torn iris edge, and pass out only the needle tip into the scleral notch. We mobilize the free end of the thread and pull it out of the anterior chamber. Fix the end of the thread with tweezers. Then we return the needle tip to the anterior chamber. 2 mm from the first puncture, we repuncture the torn iris edge and pass in the needle tip into the scleral notch. Pull the thread out of the needle, form a loop. We fix the loop with tweezers and return the needle tip to the anterior chamber. Next, we repeat the above manipulations with the iris, and the number of manipulations depends on the iridodialysis length. After the final stitching of iridodialysis, we remove the needle from the anterior chamber. The distal end of the thread is pulled out of the needle and the anterior chamber. Thus, after sewing iridodialysis of the sclera, there are two free ends of the thread and the loops between them. Then we pass the distal end of the thread through the loops towards the proximal end, pull the thread up and thereby fix the torn iris edge to the sclera. We knot the distal and proximal ends, then we bury the knot into the scleral notch. Most often, after the fixation of iridodialysis, the pupil is pulled up to the place of the fixation. Therefore, to achieve an optical cosmetic effect, it is necessary to apply knot suture to the pupillary iris edge in the projection of the iridodialysis fixation. We first introduce cohesive viscoelastic under the iris in the projection of the suture to get the maneuver and eliminate the risk of the lens damage. So, you may have noticed that in several videos presented to you, iridoplasty is performed not only a stage of a combined surgery after cataract removal, but also as the only option for eyes with clear lens. Therefore, today iridoplasty can be attributed to the category of cosmetic surgery, allowing not only restoring the anatomical parameters of the eye, but also achieving an optimal cosmetic effect. Despite our success In iridoplasty, there are situations when it is impossible to restore the diaphragmatic function of the iris with local tissues. In this case, we use a unique device developed by our Russian colleague and patented in USA. This is a monoblock artificial iris IOL. In this case, the most optimal implantation technique into the capsular bag is used. It should be noted that the device has got many modification of fixation elements that allows using it in the complete absence of capsular support and fixing it securely to the sclera. In conclusion, I would like to say that iridoplasty is one of the mainstays of a complex surgical treatment of a patient with iris defects. The restoration of anatomical structures of the anterior segment of the eye and the diaphragmatic function of the iris motivates the reconstruction of the pathological optical system and the formation of a new, more efficient one by creating optimal condition for the formation of images of the retina. Thank you so much for your attention. Не слышно, Борис Эдуардович.
Thank you very much. That was an excellent surgery. Beautiful and very nice and elegant. And I believe it's worth to ask some questions, but let's reserve them for the end of the session if we'll have time, because there are too many talks today and all of them will be nice and very educative. So let me introduce the next speaker, which is Varvara Pushchina. She is from Novosibirsk, is in the heart of Russia, in Siberia, and she will be discussing the oblique muscle surgery with manifestation, diagnosis, and treatment.
We are glad to welcome you, dear colleagues. In our opinion, despite the fact that we speak different languages, the language of strabismology is one for all. In this regard, let me share with you our experience in this matter. The functional significance of the inferior oblique muscle for human localization through three-dimensional space is undeniable. In primary position, the inferior oblique muscle causes excicular deviation, elevation, and abduction of the eye. Its primary action, as an excicular rotator, is greatest in abduction, and its action as an elevator is greatest in adduction. According to CEMS classification, overaction of the inferior oblique muscle is over-elevation in adduction. There are two clinical types of inferior oblique overaction: primary without ipsilateral superior oblique palsy or contralar superior rectus palsy, and secondary with palsy over cyclovertical muscle. In primary overaction of the inferior oblique, there is over-elevation of the abduction eye, which increases with increasing adduction. Usually, there is no vertical deviation in the primary position and no cyclo deviation. Therefore, there is no torticollis. The Pilshovsky head tilt test result is negative. Primary inferior oblique overaction are not congenital and rarely are noted in patients younger than 1 year. The patient may or may not have an associated horizontal deviation of the eyes. Primary overaction is a fairly common pathology. It is diagnosed in 72% of patients with infantile azotropia, in 30% of patients with acquired azotropia, and accounts for about 70% of all hypertropias. Oblique muscle hyperfunction was graded in the approximately 45 degrees adducted eye on a 5-point scale from 0 to plus 4 overaction. For this, the fixating abducted eye first remained elevated approximately 30 degrees above mid-level. The overaction of the oblique muscle were graded in approximately 7 degrees increments. For example, the adducted eye with the plus 4 overactive inferior oblique muscle would be approximately 22 degrees uptone than the adapted fixating eye. The basic rule of thumb is that patients with plus 4 or more inferior oblique overaction are candidates for inferior oblique surgery. Patients with minimal inferior oblique overaction but a significant V pattern are exceptions to this rule. These patients should be considered for inferior oblique weakening even though version show minimal inferior oblique overaction. Primary inferior oblique overaction is usually bilateral and almost always requires bilateral surgery. In cases of asymmetric overaction, bilateral surgery should be performed even when one eye displays only plus one overaction, to avoid unmasking the minimal overaction. If amblyopia is present, it is safer to restrict surgery to the amblyopic eye. In these cases, monocular surgery is sufficient because the sound eye is always fixing and will not manifest an upshot. The success rate after surgical treatment considered as inferior oblique underaction less than plus one. With a combination of primary overaction and azotropia, the tactics of surgical treatment depends on the features of azodivation. If the azotropia exceeds 20 degrees and abduction is limited, the first step is to weaken the medial rectus. At the second stage, the weakening of the inferior oblique muscle is performed by optimal method. If the azodivation value does not exceed 15 degrees and there is no restriction of abduction, then the first step is to eliminate the overaction of the inferior oblique muscle. Next, we eliminate the horizontal component of strabismus. Marshall Parks once described that the inferior oblique muscle surgery at the last bastion of motility disorders to be conquered. Analysis of the literature showed that over 150-year history of strabismus surgery, the techniques of weakening of the inferior oblique muscle have undergone a dramatic development and are at the same time very diverse. In our surgical practice, we use chemorecession, Z or double U-shaped partial marginal myotomy or myectomy. The choice of operation depends on the amount of hypertrophy in adduction. Botox injections are indicated for hypertrophy in adduction of no more than 15 degrees. For visualization of the inferior oblique muscle, we perform a tefornical incision. The muscle is pulled by the tenon capsule without anatomical disruption of the muscle back. Under visual control, botulinum toxin is injected with the insulin syringe. Incision is suited with 8/0 virgin silk. The duration of the procedures is 2 minutes. The success rate in chemorecession group was 91%, and these measures did not change after more than 6 months follow-up. Partial marginal myotomy are indicated for hypertrophy in adduction from 15 to 22 degrees. The marginal Z or W-shaped marginal myotomy were made using an electrocalculator. The main stages of the operation are shown in this photogram. The use of electrocoagulation technique for performing incision eliminates bleeding, muscle adhesion to the sclera, and fibrous restrictive changes in the muscle. The short time of performing myotomy contributes to an easier reaction of the surrounding muscle tissue to surgical trauma, and accordingly the postoperative rehabilitation period is more comfortable for patients. The success rate in this group was 87% respectively. Myectomy are indicated for hypertrophy in adduction more than 22 degrees. The entire width of the inferior oblique muscle is cross-clamped with two small hemostats. The hemostats should be placed approximately 10-12 mm apart, with one near the inferior oblique insertion and the other near the temporal border of the inferior rectus muscle. The muscle between the clamps is then excited with an electric actuator. The duration of myectomy is 7 minutes. The success rate in myectomy group was 94%. We observed few side effects in surgical procedures. The rate of inferior oblique overaction in camerasessional marginal myotomy and myectomy procedures was detected in 3, 4, and 3% respectively. Residual inferior oblique overaction more than plus 1 was diagnosed in 5, 10, and 3%. Although the degree of inferior oblique overaction was different in three groups, in preoperative examination, this difference was no significant at last visit. As a result, the effects of chemoresectional marginal myotomy and myectomy were equal in all patients at last visit. So, we conclude that all these three procedures are effective for treatment of primary inferior oblique overaction with minimum side effect. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Varvara. That was a really interesting talk. A bit different from what we have in the first talk, but still very relevant to our patient. And let's go to our next speaker, which comes from Yekaterinburg. Let me introduce Dmitry Ivanov, whose primary interest in today's talk will be anterior segment reconstruction in closed-angle glaucoma. Please.
Good afternoon, dear colleagues. Let me present a small video about Yekaterinburg City, where our center is located.
We are not just dreamers. We stand firmly on our feet. We have a long history behind us, with still a lot of work for us to continue. We are sure the future can be changed, but only with a well-prepared base. Our city has always been open-minded and ready to act now. We know how to achieve results. We have courage and resources, different resources, for the city of the future to flourish right here. A city of innovative technologies and respect for the environment. Yes, we are not just dreamers.
Enclosure glaucoma with organic blockade of anterior chamber angle is a serious problem, especially in Asian region. If the functional block is easily eliminated by laser iridotomy with gonioplasty and intraocular pressure is normalized. In organic blockade, laser treatment is not effective. The angle remains closed and the intraocular pressure is high. Among the feature of anterior segment of eyes with organic blockade, the following was noted. Hypertension, edema of corneal stroma, posterior synechia, irregular pupil shape, mydriasis after attack of acute angle closure, small anterior chamber. The angle of the anterior chamber is partially or completely closed. Sometimes it's not visible due to cornea edema, The technology of aberration includes replacement of the native lens with IOL. And then intraoperative gonioscopy with subsequent reconstruction of anterior segment, gonius and echo lysis with spatula, with forceps, and suturing of the iris with Asian normal shape and size of the pupil, as well as stable opening of the angle of anterior chamber. The technique of operation will be presented on clinical case, data before operation, angle closure glaucoma, mydriasis after acute angle closure attack, plata, iris. Ultrasounds by microscopy and gonioscopy demonstrate angle closure and mydriasis in eye after acute attack of glaucoma. Intraoperative gonioscopy shows angle closure. Lens is removed either with fake emulsification IOL implantation and then intraoperative gonioscopy performed again. Close angle. And then gonioscopy is performed with the forceps. Part of the angle is open. Suture are placed to the iris in order to form normal size of pupil and widen the angle. At the end of operation, gonioscopy shows open angle. Ultrasound by microscopy also proves angle opening. Data after operation in a week, in 1 year, you can see widely open the angle. Anterior segment before and after operation. In case in advanced glaucoma, the opening of the anterior chamber angle is enhanced by additional hypertensive component, abinterna trabeculotomy. Variant of surgical technique. Intraoperative gonioscopy before operation. Is closed. Remove synecdoche. Lens removed either with fake emulsification. IOL implantation the angle remains closed for advanced glaucoma excavation total excavation. And then we performed gonius and echolysis and trabeculotomy. at a distance about 2 or 3 millimeters. You can see open scleral sinus. Syngonious anachylosis with forceps. And suture. To the iris in order to form a normal size of pupil. Angle is open and part of trabeculotomy segment. This film presents the mechanism of trabeculotomy before opening the trabecula. The contrast does not spread along the natural outflow pathways. And then we perform trabeculotomy. And we note the spread of contrast along the entire circumference of scleral sinus after opening a section only 2 millimeters long. Thus the outflow along natural roads, it's completely restored. Natural pathways. The following technology designed for young patients with accommodation. On picture, mechanism of angle closure. This technology includes two stage. The first stage, laser iridotomy, eliminate pupil block, but organic block not eliminate. And if few days, you might gonius anachylosis and trabeculotomy. Picture from operation room. After iridotomy, a few days, is irrigation trabeculotome. Modification of trabeculotome. Gonius anachylosis and trabeculotomy are performed on the phakic eye. For this purpose, an irrigation trabeculotome is used. Manipulation can be performed with both viscoelastic and saline solution. Open on the scleral sinus. The image shows the result before and after the operation. The arrow shows the open area of the trabecula. Hypertensive effect in terms of more than 5 years. The proposed treatment option for angle-closure glaucoma with organic blockade are highly effective, relatively safe, and pathogenetic. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Dmitry. Very, very interesting technology, and I think it's specifically relevant for the Asia-Pacific region, where a lot of angle-closure glaucoma are related to the anterior segment of the eye anatomy, which is less prevalent in the European part of Russia, but definitely more common in the areas of eastern part of Russia, is where you live, and that's why you have a lot of experience with that technology. So let's move now to the far east, to Khabarovsk, and I would like to introduce Dr. Vladislav Tuzlaev, who will be discussing the issue of ocular reperfusion syndrome in patients with chronic ischemic retinopathy. Please, Vladislav, we're looking forward for your talk.
Hello, dear colleagues. I'm going to report on the stated topic. Chronic ischemic retinopathy is one of the clinical forms of the eye ischemic syndrome, the main cause of which is atherosclerosis of the internal carotid artery in 70% of cases. The pathogenesis of the retinopathy consists in the reduction of blood flow in internal carotid artery, retinal and choroidal vessels with the fuses development of ischemic process ranging from peripheral part of retina to the macula, which leads to a decrease in visual function. There are three degrees of severity of retinopathy, which is characterized by the appearances of ischemic zones from peripheral part of retina to the macula, depending on the number of affected quadrants. The most common complication of chronic ischemic retinopathy in carotid endarterectomy stenosis is considered to be neovascular glaucoma, then macular edema, and proliferative retinopathy. The main treatments for retinopathy are known to be carrying out panretinal laser coagulation and carotid endarterectomy. Carotid endarterectomy is considered the gold standard in the treatment of atherosclerotic stenosis of carotid arteries. The main indicators for carrying it out is 16-17% of stenosis. One of the drawbacks or weakness of carotid endarterectomy is considered a sharp recovery of arterial blood flow, which can provoke ischemic and reperfusion complication in the eye, leading to the development of proliferative retinopathy, macular swelling, neovascular glaucoma, and optic nerve atrophy. Panretinal laser coagulation, according to many authors, has proven its effectiveness. It allows to stabilize the course of retinopathy with reduced the risk of neovascularization. However, according to other authors, even after laser coagulation, choroidal ischemia persists, which is sufficient for the progression of the process in 65% of cases. In this regard, the main aim of our work was to evaluate the effectiveness of the prevention of reperfusion syndrome after carotid endarterectomy in patients with chronic ischemic retinopathy associated with hemodynamically significant stenosis of the internal carotid artery. To achieve this goal, we have developed a two-stage treatment method, including panretinal laser coagulation of the peripheral part of retina on the first stage, and 2 weeks later, on the second stage, a surgery of affected internal carotid artery was performed. The selection criteria were patients with ischemic retinopathy of third degree of severity, with hemodynamically significant stenosis of the internal carotid artery of more than 70%. The patients were divided into groups. The main group where the treatment was performed according to the proposed method, and the compression group where only carotid endarterectomy was performed. Each group included one patient with neovascular glaucoma. To evaluate the result, obtained a control group of 12 people of comparable age and gender without stenosis of internal carotid artery was selected. All patients underwent fluorescent angiography, dopplerography of eye vessels, macular angio-CT before and after treatment. To verify the degree of internal carotid artery stenosis, spiral computer tomography with X-ray contrast and ultrasound scanning were performed. To evaluate the results of treatment, we assessed the indicators of systolic blood flow rate and index of resistance in the vessels of the eye, the indicators of macular circulation, the frequency of cases of reperfusion complication, and the duration of follow-up was 12 months. The ophthalmoscopic picture of the fundus in the main and control group was identical. It was characterized by the late onset on the arterial phase, the presence of hyperfluorescent zones in four quadrants, and the macroaneurysm from macula to extreme part of retina. After the treatment, the indicators of systolic blood flow rate and the resistance index by the end of follow-up period of 12 months were closer to the indicators of the control group. The results of indicators of maculovascular density and superficial capillary plexus and the vascular density at the deep capillary plexus were closer to normal in the main group by 6 months and the compression group only by 12 months. At the same time, the best corrected visual activity in main group was higher by 6 months and in the compression group by 12 months. The optimal result of blood flow and visual activity in the main group was achieved by 6 months, and it was characterized by absence of hyperfluorescent zones, microaneurysm in all quadrants, it means four quadrants, and no signs of retinopathy progression. At the same time, the optimal result of blood flow and visual activity in the compression group was achieved only by 12 months. It was characterized by the disappearance of microaneurysm and hyperfluorescent zones from the macula to the equator by 6 months, and only by 12 months to the peripheral part of retina. And the formation of secondary neovascular glaucoma was notated in two cases of patients in this group. Let me introduce the first clinical case is the patient of main group. This slide shows the regression of neovascular glaucoma 6 months after the treatment. It means patients, when we use the propulsive method, first panretinal laser coagulation, and second stage is carotid endarterectomy of internal carotid artery. This slide shows the second clinical case of patients in compression group, and we see the progression of neovascular glaucoma after 1 month after the treatment. It means patients after carotid endarterectomy. On this slide, we show some stage of preposed method and what we do to minimize the risk of reperfusion syndromes of the eye. And conclusions. The development of the interdisciplinary step-by-step approach in the treatment of severe chronic ischemic retinopathy, first stage panretinal laser coagulation peripheral part of retina, and the second stage chronic carotid endarterectomy promotes minimizing the risk of development of reperfusion retinal complication with irreversible loss of visual function, improves of eye hemodynamics by 6 months, improving visual activity, and optimize twice the period of regression of retinopathy clinical symptoms. Thank you for attention.
Okay, thank you very much. That was really a great talk. And let me also shortly describe the ophthalmology in Russia, which is, I would love to share my screen if I will be allowed to do that in order to present a few slides about the the Russian Ophthalmology Society and the ophthalmology in Russia. I don't know if it's possible to allow me to share my screen.
That would be great.
Thank you. That will be just great to have this opportunity in order to give you a brief overview of Russian Ophthalmology Society, which was founded many years ago in 1885. That's basically where we go to back to our history. And we have a major goal of development of ophthalmology in Russian Federation, and also in creation the environment for continuous professional growth of the members of the society, protection of the members' legal rights, and strengthening the links between science and the practice, which I believe is very, very important. So we have 80 regional divisions, and as shown here, today we come from Khabarovsk, which is on the far east side, then we went to Irkutsk, and then we went to Novosibirsk, and then to Yekaterinburg. And this is a vast, a big territory of Russia, and which is basically located exactly in Asia. So this is the Russian Ophthalmology Society last meeting. We are having the big meeting every 4 years. So the last one was in 2020. So we've got it online, which is unusual, but was very successful with regard to the numbers. And we're also holding a lot of smaller meetings in different portions of Russian region. So we are a full member of International Council of Ophthalmology and having a very close relationships with many national societies such as Chinese, All India, Israeli, Brazilian, and many others. So we are holding young ophthalmologist meetings every year and during our major congresses. And this is a very important task to support the young ophthalmologists in Russia. So we publishing professional standards, clinical guidelines, as well as the journals devoted to the surgical procedures, pediatric ophthalmologists, and some other digests reviewing the recent publications and achievements in publications all over the world. So this is the newspaper that we have, which is official Russian Ophthalmology Society newspaper, founded almost 10 years ago. So this is our webpage, and we are happy to be here today with you and to share the knowledges, which was very different in devoted to different subjects of ophthalmology, from strabismus to ophthalmic diseases associated with general conditions, trauma, and glaucoma. And I want to thank all presenters today that shared with us the great knowledge and the expertise. I want to thank you all for your participation. And we are happy to continue our cooperation with the MediaMice agency in the Asia-Pacific region. Thank you very much.